I'm Emily. I am working at GitHub right now. I've been there for about a year and a half. This is my essence GIF. My team asked all of us to pick a GIF that represents themselves, and I feel like this is pretty accurate. As mentioned, I do love plants, so if you want to talk to me about something after the talk that doesn't have to do with code, talk to me about your gardens, what you're growing. I love that stuff. I've been working in React since about 2015, and a huge part of why I'm where I am today is because of the React community, so I'm really excited to get to speak here. And I recently Marie Kondo'd Twitter out of my life, so if you want to follow me, you can follow my dog on Instagram. She's the best doggo in the world. I mean, this is her pair programming with me. She's still an Angular dev, but I'm working on it. One day. And I wanted to start with the native land acknowledgement. This is something that's actually really popular in the public sector, especially in Canada. I think they do it before every school day there. But it just aims to bring recognition to the peoples whose territory we're on and to spread awareness of their histories. So today we're on Goshute land, and it's actually unceded land. So if you want to learn more about them, the first link is their website. The second link is a really cool documentary about them. And the third link is just more about native land acknowledgements. I love to see it at more tech conferences. So, so as mentioned, I work at GitHub, and I work on the Primer design system. How many of you have design systems at your company? OK, seems like maybe a third. So I'm going to talk about what design systems are and how we approach building a React component library as part of our design system. But even if you aren't currently working with a design system, I'm going to cover a lot of like general API design philosophy that could be applied anywhere. So one of the first things that people ask me when I tell them that I'm a design systems engineer, which is like the coolest title that I've had in my career so far, I love it, is they ask me to define what a design system is. So I'll just define it in my own words. I believe that a design system is an ecosystem of tools, guidelines, shared values, and principles that helps teams more efficiently ship consistent design. So the motto for design systems would be efficiently shipped, consistent design. That's kind of like the end goal. What a design system is not is just a React component library, just CSS components, or just a style guide. I really believe that a design system has to be an ecosystem, a universe of tools, in order for it to be effective. So this is our ecosystem at GitHub. We've got CSS components, React components, icon library, presentations, interface guidelines, Figma components, and just recently we started working on some Rails components that are really cool. I'm not really covering that in my talk, but if you want to talk to me about that later, I love nerding out about that too. And I really think that design systems need to be language agnostic. So maybe if you're at a really small company, you might just have one framework that you're working on for front end, but at most companies, you're going to have more than one. So at GitHub, most of github.com, which I'll probably refer to as .com just out of habit, that's what I mean when I say .com is github.com. We have lots of other things like Atom and different features, but github.com is mostly Rails, but we have other teams who are using React, we have teams who are using just vanilla JavaScript, and so our design system has to cater to all of these different teams, all these different people building different things. So you might be thinking, I'm an engineer, why should I care about this? This sounds like designer's problems. And that's kind of what I thought before I knew a ton about design systems, but I really think that design systems are the bridging the gap between design and engineering. So I think it's equal parts engineering, equal parts design. And there's a lot of reasons why a front-end engineer or a production engineer might care about design systems. The big one is communication. So there's this stereotype in tech that designers don't speak engineering and engineers don't speak design. And I think that design systems can really meet us and meet both sides and create a language that we can agree upon. So this can go all the way from like colors, color systems, spacing, all of these things that like we might go back and forth a ton on with designers. This is all just kind of laid out so everyone's on the same page and in agreement about what some terms mean. You can also move a lot faster. So if your design system incorporates tools like a component library or CSS components, that means that every time you're building a new feature, you don't have to rewrite code from scratch. So, and on top of that, with the communication, if you're not going back and forth over a sketch file all the time to try to figure out what exactly it is you're supposed to implement, you can move a lot faster. So I know in previous companies, I would kind of the workflow would for me was that I would get a sketch file, be told to implement it, and then I would go in and I would do this really silly thing where I would like draw rectangles between elements to try to figure out what the padding was. And I now know there's a lot easier way to do that in Sketch, but hopefully a design system kind of reduces that kind of busy work, I guess. And you don't have to write CSS anymore. So yeah! this is kind of an over-exaggeration, but if you do have CSS components or a library, like a React library that's got CSS and JS, hopefully you're not writing new CSS every time you build a feature. This is kind of one of the main reasons why we adopted a design system at GitHub, was that our CSS bundle was getting a little out of control. And so we needed some reusable CSS to help us move forward. Another huge bonus is accessibility. This is something that I really care about. Most of my previous conference talks have been about accessibility. Just like design systems is the overlap between engineering and design, I really think accessibility is equal parts engineering and design. So for example, color contrast is super important. That's usually something that a designer lays out in their mockups. And markup is super important for accessibility. So if the engineer implementing a design uses like non-semantic markup, that can make something really inaccessible. And so hopefully your design system can make these decisions for your engineers and your designers in one place. And that means that not every engineer has to become an expert on accessibility. I would love it if that would happen. I think everybody should know about accessibility. Oh. But that's probably not going to happen anytime soon. So a little bit about the history of design systems at GitHub. So as I mentioned before, our design system is called Plummer. It's 7 years old. Its birthday was in July. Happy birthday. And it started as sort of a pet project for a group of people at GitHub who saw the impending CSS doom that we were moving towards. So it started as mostly just a style guide and CSS components. And that was great. It meant that every time we built a new feature, we didn't have to rewrite a bunch of custom CSS. It helped keep our bundle sizes down. It was great for performance. But like every new shiny tool that you get, it ended up not being so great after a long period of time of using it. We realized, you know, it's still super useful for us, but there could be improvements that could be made. So for one, you can see this is a huge list of class names that are needed on this label in order to make this form element look good. So this is like a basic form element in an ERB file. It's got labels, it's got inputs, it's got some text. And this user had to add, like, I think there's 6 or 7 classes there to get it to look exactly right. And on top of this, they also had to know to use the right semantic markup. So in this case, they used a label with an ARIA label, which is great, but someone who maybe didn't have accessibility knowledge could have easily just put a div there and wouldn't have known that it was breaking accessibility. So we started looking for a solution that would solve a few problems that we had. One, we wanted to reduce the need to memorize class names and markup patterns. We wanted to make it easy to update components across the code base. We wanted to encapsulate CSS because we're starting to see some global CSS issues and bugs that were hard to fix. And we wanted to make theming possible or at least easier. So we decided to experiment with React, and that's kind of where I came in. I joined the team 1.5 years ago, and my primary focus has been creating Plummer components, which is our React library. This is the documentation site for it. I forgot to put a link in, but it's primer.style/components. And we have about 25 components right now. They're mostly UI components. And what I mean about that is that they don't worry too much about fetching or submitting data. Their purpose is to make it so that there are less decisions on design implementations and to make markup decisions for the user. So they're mostly just like presentational UI visual components. And we make them really easy to wrap with other components if you want to handle fetching and submitting data. So I wanted to talk a little bit about values. We actually got together as a team at the very beginning of this project to write down our principles and values. And they served as a North Star while designing the API for primer components. I really highly recommend this. I had no idea how useful it would be until I was in the dirt building these components. So the first thing is that everything is a component. This might seem like standard to a React engineer, but coming from a culture of Rails, where a lot of times there's like this huge view file and everything's in there, I can see a lot of people moving to React and trying to build a whole page in one component. So we really wanted to focus on core UI components, base components that can be composed to build bigger pieces of UI. Another one is to automate or abstract only when repetition is a hindrance. So this basically means don't abstract something just because it looks cool or because you think it's going to make your life better. Like, really think about when you're abstracting something in your code and whether or not you need that abstraction. This was like one of the hardest things for us to follow because we went into building this project with wanting it to serve many purposes, and we had some libraries we really wanted to use, and so we kind of hacked together this thing that at some point was hard for us to maintain, and that was a red flag. So from there on, I did a bunch of refactors together with the team to make it as simple and minimal as possible so that when you're looking at a file that contains a component, you can pretty much figure out what's going on. And this leads into our next value, which is to avoid implementations that reduce the ability for people to contribute. So this is especially really important for a design system because we need other people on our team, people outside of the design systems team, to contribute to our components. You can think about it like if someone is building a feature at GitHub and they have a deadline and they want to use our components, but our components just don't fit the need exactly, they shouldn't have to wait like 2 weeks for us to get around to doing it. They should be able to jump in and do it themselves. Another big one is assume that people will break the rules and provide safe ways for them to do so. So this is kind of more of a general design systems philosophy, but I think it can also be applied in other APIs. So while one of the goals of a design system is to enforce consistent UI, successful design systems tools must also provide some flexibility to its users. Otherwise, you're going to have a stagnant component library that can't really adapt to real-life implementations. So we offer utility props on most of our components that we use styled system to generate, and it allows users to some flexibility when it comes to color and spacing and those kinds of things. And another important aspect of providing safe ways for people to break rules is our theme. So a theme is a collection of common design values, like spacing, font sizes, colors, and all kinds of different things. And so while you're able to tweak some styles using styled system props, adjusting these values with other values from the theme helps us keep the design iterations within the realm of our design system. So that's been really important for us. So the takeaway here is to establish values early on. They can change, they can mold and flex as you learn more, but try to get those down before you start building. So I'll go into a couple of technology decisions that we made. I won't go into the nitty-gritty. That's another great thing for you to hit me up after the talk about, because that's kind of a better in-person conversation. But there are a few things that are really core to our system that I want to cover. So the first one is to use theme values whenever possible. This is a screenshot of our theme. It's kind of hard to see, but it basically outlines like lots of different things. So we have breakpoints, max width, fonts, font weights, colors, font sizes, all these different things live in this theme file. It's just a big object. And whenever we're writing styles, almost every time we're writing styles, we pull from that theme. So styled system is doing some of the work here. The get function is imported from styled system, but basically So we're setting the font weight here. That pulls the bold value in the font weight object. The font size pulls the fifth value in the font sizes array. And then that gets translated to a CSS value. We're also heavily using styled system, as I mentioned before, for our utility props. Styled system is a really cool library written by Brent Jackson. And it's a little hard to explain. The Cliff Notes version is basically, it allows you to add props on your components that translate into CSS. So in this example, M is shorthand for margin. I'll get into the funky syntax later. Font size, width. So we'll start with the easy ones. Font size, it's pulling the third value from the font size object in the theme. Width is pulling the sixth value from the spacing object in the theme. And then for margin, it also has the ability to do responsive values. So at different breakpoints, you can designate different values. So this is also really helpful for like display props. If you want to hide things at certain breakpoints, you can do that. And going back to here, this typography and common variable that's getting applied in our styled component, that is corresponding to groups of styled system props. So we don't have to implement that logic of like, okay, the user said four for the M prop. How do we translate this to CSS? Styled system takes care of all of that for us, and that's all we have to do in the component file. So that's really cool. A few final thoughts. Work in the open. This was paramount to the success of this project. So we made a lot of breaking changes in the beginning, but we were very upfront that like, this is not production ready yet. Don't use this. But we really wanted to have our repo public so that people could see what we were doing and ask questions and poke and prod. Another thing that we did was we had Spectrum open office hours. So every Friday, I think it was from like 1 to 2, anyone from within GitHub or outside of GitHub could come in and ask questions. And that was really cool because people would ask me questions, like for instance, this is like, why did you decide to use CSS and JS instead of relying on the primer CSS library that you already have? And I had already made that decision and felt pretty good about it, but having to explain it to someone else really made me feel confident about it and really made me think through all of the pros and cons. And people have brought up things that I have decided, oh yeah, that isn't a great API, and I've changed things, so that's been really cool. Also, your issue tracker, when people submit issues, I like to view that as treasure and a gift from that person. It's really easy to get defensive when someone posts an issue on your baby pet project, but it really is someone else doing your job for you, so that's really cool. And I try to treat that person with that kind of that warmth and gratitude. So you're probably not going to get it right the first time around. That's what your beta version is for and what your tests are for. This is a screenshot of me searching for the word refactor. And I did this in March, so there's probably a lot more, but I had 35 PRs that reference refactoring. So I'm always refactoring. It's part of my core values. And that's it. My slides are on bit.ly/mplums. Feel free to reach out to me after this. I'll be around all day. And thank you.